Thank Jerry for the kind and informative introduction. And thank you all for coming tonight. I'm overwhelmed by this such a large number of audience. And today I'm going to talk about a big topic on China. And I think this is a topic could be a one semester subject. And this is a big task for me to finish this big topic within 45 minutes. So I will try to figure out something I need to say because everybody know China in a different way. We get newspapers report, we get TVs, we get all the things about China nowadays. And you all know a lot of things about China. But what I can give you today, I think should be unique. So what I think about is really about how can we read the Chinese mind? And how can we see their judgment on certain issues? What's the trigger? What's the reason for them to think in this way? What's the reason for them to react in another way? For example, in terms of international relations, in terms of economic development, in terms of human rights, in terms of all the tensions, whatever. So we have to understand that maybe the elite, the intellectuals and the leaders, whatever, the citizens, what they are thinking about of China. And that's maybe the reason for tonight. I can give you some different perspectives. In particular, I just made a joke with Professor Griffiths that is, I was born during the Great Famine period, 1961. So I was a little bit shorter than the younger generation now. So I experienced Cultural Revolution. And as you know, during the Cultural Revolution, most intellectuals were punished or have a very difficult times, including my family. And I was 6 years old. My brother was 15 years old. He was taken to Inner Mongolia, settled down in the countryside. And my parents were in the labor camps. And my older sister was 11. And we are looking after each other in Beijing. Basically, a very hard time. So there's a lot of personal, maybe, attachment to the presentation as well. So I think that maybe give you some personal flavor, like a cooking Sichuan food with a spicy thing. So some kind of Chinese, as a Chinese person, give you some kind of that perspective. But I try to keep distance a little bit because I'm a scholar, I'm intellectual. I should be neutrally observing or judging things in China, in related to China issues. So that's the conceptual underpinning for me to talk about. So in a way, I try to guide you maybe through 45 minutes to look at the evolutionary characteristics of reform in China from historical, cultural, political, and economic perspectives. Even I'm a scholar in the HR, IR, or economics area, but I try to bring other things into the consideration tonight. Secondly, we try to examine the role of the state and the related policy implications for that. So the implication could be related to China, implication could be related to the international community, including Australian community. Thirdly, I want to evaluate the transition process in China by defining the socialist market economy with Chinese characteristics. I have my own interpretation regarding that terminology. And be warning, in a sense, I'll use a lot of Chinese jargon from time to time because I give this Chinese jargon first, then interpret, explain the meaning of jargon so you understand why the Chinese people or Chinese newspaper or leaders using this jargon. For example, harmonious society or connecting with international track. So all this terminology they use with a particular purpose. So that's maybe can really enrich the understanding about the Chinese process or decision-making process. Yeah. So generally speaking, nowadays newspapers or the media talk about the GDP growth. Really the remarkable things in China, you can see the figure show the recent years. Normally it's about 10%, sometimes higher, more than 10%. During the global financial crisis is above 6%, but increasingly this level into the 13%, so on and so forth. Even this year, it's about 9.5% to 10%. This is a general picture, rosy picture about China. It grows so rapidly, and there's a kind of a two sides of the one coin. On the one hand, international community benefit from the economic prosperity and development in China. Certainly Australia, we benefit a lot from China's prosperity. On the other hand, people worry about the emergence of China. There's a neighboring country worry about the expansion so quickly, and we don't know what's the next step of China, and in particular giving the territorial some kind of uncertainty there, in particular related to some kind of maybe economic, financial disagreement, whatever. People worried about China's action. So there's a China threat versus a China's prosperity. So we have a conflicting attitude or feelings toward China. We want them to be successful, want to have economic prosperity, so we can benefit from that. But on the other hand, we worry about China. We are not sure about the future of China. So that's the dilemma we are facing as an international community. But on the other hand, maybe Chinese feel differently. And we'll talk about the Chinese feelings inside China. And then we can compare these kind of two perspectives. That's interesting. Another important figure, I only have two figures today, not the mathematical, not the economic kind of a data presentation tonight. Yeah, basically, this is important figure, the China GDP per capita. If we use constant price, we can see it's around $2,000. But if we use the purchasing power parity price, PPP US dollar, China nearly reached, certainly this year will be $6,000 US dollar per capita GDP based on PP price is an important signal. Why I say that? A lot of political science people saying that this is a remarkable thing indicate the country moving into enlightenment of democracy, there's urbanization, there's emerging middle class. I give you some data here. They're saying that China actually lived 200 million people out of poverty. And China, based on this six national census data, they show that nearly 49.7% urban population now, nearly 50% of urban populations. You can see the migration from a rural area into urban area, and they are engaging the urban lifestyles. Yeah. So the urbanization increased about 13.46% from 2000. So this is remarkable kind of change of population landscape. So you can see the emerging middle class requiring citizens' rights, requiring transparency, requiring government accountability. All these things may be coming into the kind of political arenas now. So then we can see there's a continuing kind of upheavals, uprisings, demonstrations, so on and so forth, in particular in the labor areas. You can see there's awareness of a citizen's right, of labor's right, putting on the pressure on government to govern the society in a good way, I can say. But I want to tell you the mindset. What the government thinking? What's the elite thinking? What are the intellectual thinking? What's the citizen thinking? And do we see some commonality there? And do we see some differences there? Yeah, we go back to history. The first question I ask myself, what driving forces influence the evolution? And for what purpose? This is a question I ask myself. Why China experienced such change in recent years, but that's related to the history? We need to go back to maybe early, let me say 1919, the 4th of May movement. Yeah. But maybe beyond that, even earlier, I check some kind of information data, like there's a famous book called Chinese Capitalism between 1522 and 1840. Before Opium War, China was one of the largest. Some people say that China is the largest economy in the world. Until the Opium War happened, China started to decline. Now, maybe this is a revitalization of China become the largest economy again. So there's a circle we can see. So then, coming to the 4th of May movement in 1919, the reason is related to the new cultural movement. The intellectuals, including nationalist movement, communist movement together, were thinking that the reason why China was defeated by the foreign powers, including Japan, they can invade China, we can abuse Chinese citizens on the Chinese soil. One famous symbol is we can see, go to Shanghai, the museum, there's an old park in the foreign territory, kind of foreign concession area, showing that a dog and Chinese are not allowed to get in. The Chinese equal dog in the imperialist eyes. So then the intellectual asked them question, what's wrong with us? I said, okay, we have to find the reasons. The reason for China become poor, so-called, or not competitive, not powerful enough to define themselves is because culture. We have an old culture. We have a feudalism. We have these bad royal families. We have a Confucianism, too conservative. We killed all the innovation. We don't really looking forward. We are looking backward. So then, in order to change Chinese society, we need to change mentality. We need to change education. We need to change culture. So the new cultural movement started. As you know, Lu Xun, Hu Shi, Chen Duxiu, all the leaders, intellectuals, moving toward that direction. There are no division between communists and nationalists. They're working together for the common goal of rebuilding nation, rebuilding a new, strong nation. Even Chiang Kai-shek, Sun Yat-sen, Communist Party member, Mao Zedong, Zhou Enlai, Deng Xiaoping, all belong to that kind of movement, move forward for a strong nation. So this is a fundamental understanding about intellectuals' influence in the transition process. So then we say that during this, between 1919 and 1949, we can see there's a lot of turmoils. Japanese invasion, everybody know, World War II, then civil war between communists and nationalists, and eventually the communists are defeated nationalists, set up a so-called PRC, People's Republic of China. So this may be the symbolic things in 1949 as a new independent nation was established. So then the realization of the new nations and then go through a lot of change, socialist construction and political campaigns. I'm not getting into that details. There are too many campaigns, anti-registration campaign, Great Leap Forward campaign, all this campaign. Maybe one of the reasons for that is because they don't have experiences of developing so-called socialist economy. They are following Soviet Union. But Mao believed that the Soviet Union model is so conservative. We can do something differently, like a guerrilla war. We can use guerrilla war strategy to develop economies. That, like you see, the Great Leap Forward, these things. And then national disaster happened, economy went down, and basically the country collapsed. And then Mao's popularity became a question. And then Mao feel worried about someone take over the power, then carry out the Cultural Revolution. And then I can see the Cultural Revolution is really anti-cultural movement. Yeah, I don't want to get into that details. Now, until 1976, there's a Gano 4, Mao died, and we arrest Gano 4, and then Hua Guofeng was the successor of Mao. This is a crucial moment people forget. Between 1976 and 1979, before China started open-door economy policy, that it was an ideological debate between one group, so-called conservative leaders, led by Hua Guofeng, believed two principles. Two principles means as long as Mao said something, it's correct. As long as Mao did something, that was correct. So don't change everything. We follow Mao's revolutionary track. On the other hand, led by Deng Xiaoping, another so-called reformist leader, saying that China can no longer follow that Mao system. China will bankrupt. China no future on follow this track. So we are going to develop a new system, so-called economic reform, open-door policies. So after this debate, you know that in a communist society, ideological green light is a fundamental for move forward, for proceed the new kind of policies. So after this debate, eventually Deng Xiaoping win the debate and then getting into the power and influence the economic reforms. So since 1979, and China started economic reform, and then the economic reform started until now. So this is kind of a transformation. nation-building strong country, change culture, into establishing a new PRC through a lot of struggles, then engaging new economic development under Deng Xiaoping leadership. Then we see the second question is China moving toward a convergent model similar to the West under this kind of reform, so-called market economic reform, with political democracy and the market economy? It's a big question. Yeah. So in the way that I try to identify some key element during this period, since reform started, to see what's the trajectory of China reform, what's the philosophical or ideological underpinnings of these reform actions. So firstly, I want to say that the process of reform started agricultural sectors and rural area, but basically seeing that rural sectors suffered hugely under the so-called socialist construction period under Mao regime, because agriculture suffers for industrialization. Government restored price, making the peasant's life miserable. So for the survival of a communist regime, on one hand, and also for the economic development and get support from masses, Deng Xiaoping was very clever, saying that we need to lift the living standards of peasants, because at that time, nearly 80% of the population are peasants. So that is important, lift their living standards. And then we will support reform. So land reform, we say that, household registration, household kind of a responsibility system, all of the details, giving basically sovereign rights to peasants to own piece of land and to produce things on their land and sell the goods in the free market. So then ease that tension and lift economic foundation. And then started urban reform with a dual system. Why started dual system? The meaning of dual system is planning system here, market system there. So China's reform is different from Russia or Soviet Union, former Soviet Union, and Eastern European country. They have so-called shock therapy. So in the very short period of time, they privatize everything, moving from planning system into market system. But China was a transition under the parallel system for a while. The reason, one is ideological reason. There's still a large number of leaders, so-called conservative leaders, they don't want to move into a free market system. They say it's the capitalism. And Deng Xiaoping believed that certainly the phenomenon of so-called metaphor, the cat-mouse theory, as you know, white cat, doesn't matter white cat, black cat, as long as the cat catch mouse, a good cat. Yeah, so pragmatism, realistic approach toward reform. And then in the sense that is these kind of two arguments influence people's mind in a way that be cautious of reform. Can we move forward into free market system overnight? Oh, and also there's argument about, do we give up socialism? That's important. Yeah. If we move into market economy overnight, do we see ourselves as a socialist country? Because they believe planning system is one of the fundamental elements of socialism. So in Chinese term, we say that there's a debate of xing shi, xing zi, means there's a debate of surnames of socialism versus a debate of surname of capitalism. I mean, the surname is important. It's a society identity. Yeah. So in a way, are you a socialist country or are you a capitalist country? So in other countries, it's a silly argument. But for China at that moment, it's important because there's no 100% green light for free market economy. So you understand that. But maybe the good thing is that the transition is a step-by-step, gradualist transformation. When the physical reform, financial reform, there are a lot of documents on that. Basically, the banks used to be the pocket of treasury ministry. And then separate them, allow the bank become a commercial bank. And then treasury manage other things, so separate them. So then encouraging loans, borrowings, whatever, financial market, including developing share market. As you know, in Shanghai, in Shenzhen, they are very developed share market now. and certainly open up economy in a cautious way, like a special economic zone, open cities and regions. 14 these regions around the East Coast. Why? Not opening all country, just open special zones. Experimental things. They don't have experiences. They worry about open up China. If we went wrong, everything will be collapsed. We don't have experience dealing with a market economy. Better try in a small designated areas. If everything going well, then expand it. If not going well, we can eliminate it quickly. So that's a kind of cautious approach toward the economic reform and open up policies. Yeah. Certainly, parallel economic system, you have planning, you have this kind of a market economy, you have different prices. Powerful people control the material, can benefit from the planning price into market price. Yeah? Give you an example, I was working in Shenzhen Special Economic Zone. There are a lot of construction companies need construction materials. If the Bureau of Construction Materials chief, they can issue a letter saying this concrete, this is kind of steels, for example, it's a planning price from inland China. Moving into Shenzhen Special Economic Zone, it's a price like Hong Kong. And if I issue this note to you, you would benefit. And then you share the benefit with me. So the corruption is out of control. Corruption, the system really institutionalizes the corruption. And certainly there's no political reform, not very much political reform. If you remember, there's so many campaigns during the 80s, anti-bourgeoisie movement. Remember that? And in 84, 87, certainly Hu Yaobang, the former party secretary, was resigned due to the so-called anti-bourgeoisie movement campaign. Believe that they're too open, too westernized. We don't need that. And that leads to trouble. So then you can see this kind of a building up momentum, corruption, no equal rights, and there's a business government connected with each other, doing the dirty deals, and young people, in particular intellectuals, fight up with this. The trigger for Tiananmen Square movement was due to the death of a former party secretary Hu Yaobang. So because he was in the party committee saying that we need to clean up the party, otherwise party will be destroyed by the corruption, things like that. And he was so emotional making this speech, and suddenly heart attack, and he died in a meeting. So everybody remember him, then go to Tiananmen Square, went to Tiananmen Square, demonstrate that we remember the former leaders, and we want to clean up, we want to freedom of association, freedom of media, whatever, freedom of citizenship, whatever. And we need a political reform. So that's in a way the crackdown, as you know, the Tiananmen massacre happened. Yeah. But after 3 years, under the leadership of Jiang Zemin and Li Peng, they didn't do very much. And Deng Xiaoping was blamed. Because Deng Xiaoping blamed that certainly he allowed things happening this way. And he had to clean up. And some rumors saying that he was not popular in Beijing, but he moved to Shenzhen. So it's called a thousand trip speech. He went to Shenzhen, went to Zhuhai, said, we need to continue to open door policy, continue economic reform. If someone stands to block the reform, they should resign. The indication that he criticized Central Party Committee at that moment. And then, initially, the Shenzhen local newspaper reported that. And China Daily, or People's Daily, didn't want to report that. Because they say, oh, this is taboo things, can we do that or not? And eventually, Deng Xiaoping forced them to report, from copy the Shenzhen newspapers, and then become news in the entire countries. So that's kind of a momentum that we need to move forward. So anyway, this is a movement that is you need for the reform. Reform is a fully engaged free market economy. So move into so-called adopt planning system, drop the planning system, move to market economy. So the policy shift very quickly. As you know, the privatization happened in the middle 1990s. The labor law was introduced in the middle 1990s because layoff, insurance, so on and so forth, contract. All the issues come in like that. Yeah. So they formally adopt the socialist market economy in 1982. Then it's, in a way, we try to identify some of the development since then, that is the state become less involved with business activities. Yeah. But they allow companies to play among themselves. So increasingly diversity of ownership state-owned land prices become smaller, the proportion in terms of contribution to GDP and export. Increasing number of domestic private companies and increasing number of foreign investment companies. So last month, we have a social science academy delegation came over. The President Liu mentioned that nearly 50% of export from China came from multinational companies, not from Chinese indigenous companies. And other data show that more than 50% of GDPs came from private sectors, not from the public sectors. So all the change shift very quickly. And certainly, there's a 1997, 98 financial crisis, Asian financial crisis. So every country devalued their currencies. But China did good things at that time. Didn't devalue the Chinese renminbi, but also giving financial support to the neighboring countries. So China, Asia basically overcome that difficulty very quickly. But the landmark is joining WTO. I think that joining WTO, so the symbolic meaning is China become more confident to be engaged with global community. And China accept international rule and want to play this rule accordingly. This is a very symbolic, meaningful action, joining WTO. And that shows certain confidence among the leadership and business as well. So problem, challenge. Diversity is a very important element, rich versus poor. As you know, some people say that 10% of population control 90% of wealth in China. And some people say Gini coefficient, official data is 0.47. Unofficial data is 0.53. It's much higher than the dangerous line, as you know. And urban-rural divisions, that's very obvious. Yeah, the urban citizens enjoy so many benefits. But the rural citizens, not many benefit for them. And certainly East Coast versus inland Western regions. Former urban workforce versus domestic rural migrant workers. There's very different entitlement conditions. Rural workforce working for employment agency in the construction site, paying by hour rate or piece rate, or maybe not getting paid until the end of the year. You can see not paying the wage arrears problem is a very significant problem in China. But a lot of the problem due to the government didn't pay the project. I give you an example. Government have project, want to build big buildings. And then they contract with developers. And developers sign subcontract with a kind of construction workers, a kind of team. And then government didn't pay the developers. And developer cannot pay the workers. And workers for years didn't get money. Didn't get to pay. So this is a very serious problem. Even now, there's still a problem like that. Yeah. Certainly, this leads to social unrest. And social unrest is the challenge. We say that the labor dispute, you can see the demonstrations in Shenzhen, in Dongguan, in Guangdong in particular, the wages related issue, overtime pay, not paid, or pay less, or compensation for injury. A lot of injured workers, we visit hospitals, we visit the workers' dormitory, be injured, and didn't get the pay. They lose the arm, lose the leg, whatever. No adequate compensation. Huge grievance among these people. But don't forget, they are the contributor for the wealth of China created. Huge foreign reserve, $3.2 trillion this year, foreign currency reserve. And these people get injured, no pay, nobody pay them. So you can see working conditions sometimes terrible. Yeah, working longer hours, you see the suicide things happening in Foxconn in Guangdong. Yeah. And also the role of official unions, worker association, and support groups is emerging. So in a way, there's a grassroots emerging protection for workers. This is an indication of civil society emerge. Protecting themselves, like Tongxianghui, same village associations, workers working in Guangdong, maybe come from Henan, and they form their own protection group to look after each other. Because there are no effort from government or from the local trade union to protect them. So this is kind of a grassroots associations emerge. Also dispute between individual households, developers, government regarding property rights. You can see demonstrations on the street, on TV. Yeah? Some people even try to suicide to protect their property. Yeah? So this is kind of a kind of a relocation related issues. Government want to build a highway, government want to build a big dam, government want to build an airport, just relocate people with a very limited compensations. And they create huge grievance. Industrial pollution, certainly you go to Beijing, you go to Shanghai, whatever, very hard to breathe. Yeah, this is a very obvious one. And that's related to social unrest. For example, some foreign investors go into Fujian, for example, go to Guangdong, invest in chemical factories, very close to the neighborhood, very close to the citizen kind of residential areas. And then there's a citizens organized demonstrations, try to block this investment. Certainly corruption related to social unrest. As you know, this has become a cancer within the party. In the party, there's a very open talk about the corruption. This is a cancer. Premier Wen Jiabao, President Hu Jintao, always saying this is a cancer. They will kill party. They will kill the republic. Everybody knows this, but it's really not effective clean up these things. So in a way, there's a crying for further political reform. Inflation-related social unrest. As you know, last month, in June, the inflation rate was 6.4%, and just yesterday, July inflation rate was 6.5%. And so these are worrying signals. Yeah. And Wen Jiabao make an open speech saying that corruption and inflation will destroy the party very quickly. He knows that. Minority issues and unrest, Tibetan issues, Mongolian issues, Xinjiang, the unrest, all the things. Yeah, I'm not getting into that details. But there's agreements as well. And also funny thing is the central government fight with the local government. People didn't realize that. They think it's a Communist Party control hierarchy like that. The lower officials try to do very bad things. And the central government cannot control them. The Chinese phenomenon is so-called, you have policy from above, you have a counter policy below, from below. So this is the kind of phenomenon. It's local government doing a lot of things, like a property development. You see the price of a property is so high, an individual household cannot afford to buy an apartment like that. Due to the land, because the local government selling the land to the developer, and local government get the revenue from that. So they are not going to reduce the price of land, and that lead to the price of houses or apartment so expensive. Even government, central government tried to pass so many regulations, not very effective, because the interests of local government benefit from that, plus corruption, corrupt leaders. So you can see, China is not in harmony. That's the reason the government said we need to create harmonious society. Otherwise, China can every minute collapse like that. So there's a lot of scenario about what's going to move forward for the future China. Maybe possible, it's very hard to predict future. It's also dangerous to predict future, particularly to China. Anything can happen. So I'm quite brave today. Give you some my prediction. Maybe I was wrong. And then maybe in 5 years, 10 years, or listen to this professor called Ying, he says some nonsense. And then maybe 5 years ago told us this will happen. And then it happened. Didn't happen. Whatever. But I try to figure out things like that. I think it's a moment for the political reform, in particular given the new leadership will move in next year. As you know, Hu Jintao and Wen Jiabao will be retired in 2012. New leader Xi Jinping will replace Hu Jintao as a president and party leader, and Vice Premier Li Keqiang is our Beida alumni, will be the premier. So new leadership normally have an ambition. They didn't show at the moment. But the rumors saying that these people will do some big actions, in particular related to political reform. But coming to the question, is China going to Western democracy? Maybe not. China may have some unique way of managing that democratic issues. Maybe democracy within the party first. People were saying that they have a local elections at a kind of a village and township level, and maybe we will promote that to the upper level, to the maybe county level. And people suggest that maybe party leaders at the provincial level should be elected. So there's all indication about people's representation within the political party institutions. For example, they are inviting different interest groups join the party, including bourgeoisie class, join the parties. And you have a representative from workers, you have a representative from intellectuals, whatever. And also People's Congress also is a melting pot. And every year the People's Congress meeting is so fascinating if you follow the TV news. The entrepreneurs emphasizing how can we minimize costs, how can we reduce the labor, blah, blah, blah. And the labor the leader saying, we need to have a higher minimum wages, the workers suffering so much. So you can see the debate openly, representing different interest groups in the People's Congress platform. This is kind of gradually political reform, but in a way that this argument and debate is trying to ready for full democracy. This is all not quite sure, but I believe rule of law is more important at this stage. Because you can see that China passed a lot of law, a lot of legislation, including smoking, banning smoking inside, but the enforcement law is a problem. And people's, individuals' awareness of respecting law and following the law is a question. So in a way that rule of law is a more important kind of issues for China. Party follow the law, leader follow the law, citizen follow the law. And then moving to democracy could be more successful rather than suddenly you have free election, we have these kind of things, then Thailand things, whatever, using money, buy tickets, and nobody follow the rule, nobody follow the law. It's all based on connections, guanxi. I think that will be out of control. I think it's maybe a kind of a pragmatic stage by stage moving toward the future. Good thing is new social media is coming in. And the citizenship participation is overwhelmingly developed. I give you some examples. Yeah? For example, we say personal income tax issues. As you know, China started introduce personal income tax in 1994. The beginning level of the taxable income is 800 yuan, and it gradually increased the bar into, 1600 yuan in 2006, 2000 yuan in 2008, and now this year there was debate. We should we move to 2500? Or 3,000, or 3,500? Should we reduce the percentage of individual income tax, whatever? So there's a huge debate. The data show that 230,000 people email labor ministry saying that we want this, we want this. Majority of people want 3,500, because government think maybe 3,000 is good. But overwhelmingly, people want 3,500, leave the bar. So if China reached that level, like people earn more than 3,500 yuan per month, then they pay tax, pay 3% rank one the tax like that. But there are how many people? 60 million now paying tax under the new rule. That's remarkable. 60 million people don't need to pay tax. They save a lot of money, consume, right? They can buy things for their household. So don't forget, this is the majority population are still poor. So in that sense, I think that it's kind of giving a chance for people earn more money to consume more, develop the domestic market. So then they share the wealth like that. So in that sense, we say, citizen participation, influence, eventually government gave up the 3,000 benchmarking, moved to 3,500. Yeah. So that's kind of indication that social media, through internet, through this Twitter, whatever, QQ, this debate, you can see very, very, very active debate on China. They have a web page on who is the corrupted leaders. And then they name the person. And the government would do the investigation if they provide evidence. So this kind of participation through this kind of new social media and internet participation like that, representing new generation of citizens' participation. Are they relatively young? Generation X or Generation Y, say post 80, post 90, 80后, 90后, this kind of phenomenon. I mentioned that promoting the rule of law. That's important. For example, how can we behave ourselves? It's important. Yeah. Citizens not only asking for freedom and rights, but also citizens respect law and monitoring other people's behavior, control social order by themselves. That's important. So that's an important issue about influence of civil society. We have emerging this kind of NGO group, emerging of the trade union, kind of very loosely arranged kind of worker protection groups, minority groups, so on and so forth. And that eventually would be an influential political body engaging political dialogue. So I think it's important to move from a no dialogue, no negotiations, move into have some dialogue, and more dialogue negotiation between rulers, we say, or party leaders, and the government systems, and with the citizens. Yeah. Without that kind of dialogue and compromise negotiations, and then the country could be very dangerous. So given that the economy is going well, given that income level is going up, given that emerging middle class, it's all possible. Now coming to the concept of socialist market economy with Chinese characteristics. What is the political meaning? Socialism in Chinese term is a public ownership, 公有制, planning economy, 计划经济, egalitarian principle, 平等. Not all of them in China now. Why need socialism? There's political needs. Without socialism as a surname, we say surname, we don't need the Communist Party. Without socialism, Communist Party will be eliminated. So by political legitimacy of Communist Party, they need to restore the socialism. But what's the really they are doing is a market economy, doing everything they can in order for economic development. Because you understand, with economic development, the regime can survive. The good example or bad example is the Soviet Union and Eastern Europe. The economy didn't develop, they collapsed. Nobody supports them. Then, what's the social cultural meanings here? There's a revitalization of this Confucianism, traditional culture, traditional value. Why? Ideological vacuum. Nobody believes in communism. People join the party not because they believe in communism, because there's opportunities. You become powerful people, you must be party members. Young people join the parties for the climbing the power hierarchy. So the safe way for country to maintain that social harmony or social order is a reinviting Confucianism or Taoism or traditional value coming back. Because people can easily understand, because they're rooted in the family, relationship building, and that kind of things. But so in a way that social cultural values, in that sense, make the society relatively safe in terms of transformation. As you know, money-driven mentality is obvious in China, and it's out of control. And then how can we control that situation? Maybe by using some traditional values into that kind of a concept. But another way, maybe it's a conspiracy theory, I think so. If everything going right way, that'll be all Chinese characteristics. If something going wrongly, that's the Western bourgeoisie, can easily cut, not belong to us. The regime is safe. Yeah, this is calculated behavior in that sense. Then coming to the conclusion, what are the unique characteristics and implication of the evolution of Chinese society? I think Chinese society, given the historical background, how many times we left? 10 minutes? 10 minutes? 5 minutes, yeah. You can see there's a common goal, that is building a strong nation, building an independent nation, and Chinese people can no longer be abused as a dog. The education is very, very strong. That signals when we saw the picture in this classroom, you can feel the young people, how do they think in history of China, right? So government use these things as, okay, we need an independent, strong country. and China will be an equal partner with all the other nations in the world. The Chinese have a particular term saying that, so-called 立足于世界民族之林, means equally partner with all other nations. Because we are not equal before. We were not equal before. No, we must be equal with others. Yeah. Politically, Communist Party of China is less ideological driven party compared with Soviet Union Party or Eastern European Communist Party. They are more pragmatic, in particular like Deng Xiaoping. Yeah. So that ideological driven action become less significant, in particular in recent years. More pragmatic, realistic approach are important for the transformation. But the China transition is not stopped. Need forward, move forward, as I mentioned, this political reform. Everybody blamed China's problem coming to the system problem. 制度问题, the problem of the system. What's the 制度? 制度 system, the political system. The government system, all the systems need to be reformed. Yeah. This is the moment you need to move to that. I'm saying that is the two sides of the coins, some positive things, but also combined with some negative things. Yeah. So that is the kind of a Chinese kind of a thinking in a way that they don't want to move too quickly and lose control. But if they become too conservative and people will push them. Yeah. You can see the push, people are pushing now. There's a fast train, the accident, you can see. The government was so embarrassed. Everybody say, stop fasting movement. Please, we want to benefit these things. We don't want too fast, and we get lost. The newspaper saying that, don't move too fast. We cannot catch up with you. So that's kind of a strong signal, it's consolidation now. You move too fast already, no consolidation. Share the wealth now. Rather than just a small minority control the majority wealth. Yeah, that's important. Political things. Economic things, I think. One of good things, I talk good things and bad things. Yeah. Good things, I think reform liberate individuals' entrepreneurship. The Chinese are very good doing business, but under planning system, they cannot do business. But now, under Deng Xiaoping, everybody can be entrepreneur. I give you an example, I went to Yunnan province. In the middle of nowhere, it's a mountain, something like, we just have a restaurant holiday like that. There's two young people from Fujian province coming there, selling their products from Fujian. And they are selling their products from Fujian hometown and getting money, buy something from Yunnan flowers. And then send to Fujian. Young people doing this. Very successful, but hardship. Yeah, you have to look after yourself, long trip, this kind of thing. But this entrepreneurship rooted in their gene, and then there's a liberation opportunity for them to be entrepreneur. I think that's one remarkable thing of reform, liberate the entrepreneurial spirit. Another thing is, we talk about economic principle comparative advantages. Everybody knows that China has a cheap labor, used to be cheap land, land is no longer cheap now. What other things cheap? I don't know. China become very expensive, but used to be cheap land, cheap labor, like that. There's a kind of a comparative advantages. But Chinese government, I think, is not relying on this kind of comparative advantage all the time. They use this comparative advantage to accumulate wealth by using this money for creating competitive advantages. They're different from other countries. We have huge resources, we just use resources, sell them, no worries. But China is not. We use cheap labor at the moment, but we use this money to build a fast train, aircraft, all the things, and then we compete with others later. So that's a kind of a calculated thinking and behavior that is in a way not relying on your natural endorsement, but you're creating your competitive advantages by using this wealth. I think that's good things from certain perspective. But the bad thing is too much investment. People say that the fixed assets investment in China share 50% of GDP. And the investment on the return on investment, the ratio is declining. Used to be 3.5 to 1, now it's a 4.3 to 1. You put more money in, you get a little bit of GDP back. This way is no longer sustainable. So they have to think about the other way of things. Now, people say that China needs to transform economy from a manufacturing-oriented economy to service economies, but the transition could be very difficult as well. But everybody knows that government don't invest in American treasury bonds. It's a $1.2 trillion, that kind of American treasury bonds. The money is shrinking, you know? Recent crisis, all things, US dollar went down, and all the reserve went down. So using the money, invest in social infrastructure, pay adequate social insurance, share the wealth with the poor people, and people can consume more, and economy transforms from export-oriented, always export, to domestic consumption-oriented, and build the wealth within your own people. And some people say that, make a joke, because Jerry and myself, we went to Vietnam, the infrastructure is so poor. But Vietnamese people are very rich. This is a rich people, poor country. But China is opposite, rich country, poor people. So then in that way, I consider how can make people rich, benefit the economic prosperities. Yeah? So that's kind of an economic problem, need to change that. And I think that the social issues really about citizenship, public well-being, and then when you have a citizenship to be respected, and the individual participate, the citizenship things, yeah, and then engage in this dialogue, and then you reduce the grievance, and you reduce the tensions, and certainly the harmony will be reinstalled. I think that's kind of a general overview of Chinese society in transition. But before I finish, I will say something about the center. Yeah. You can see China is so important, India is so important, Japan is so important, everyone knows Asia is very important for us, in particular for Australian future development. So the establishment of Center of Asian Business is really for that purpose. We are engaging public debate, we are informing public about our neighboring countries. If you need more services, for example, research services, we can do so. If you need business advice, we can also do so. So this is a very good opportunity for the center to meet with our local community members and share our understandings about Asian economy, in particular on China tonight. Thank you so much tonight.
There are some questions.